Hello, everybody, and welcome to Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition. I'm Stephanie Meyers, Nutrition Coordinator at the Zakim Center for Integrative Therapies and Healthy Living. And I'm really happy that you're here to talk today about cauliflower, a vegetable that I think is sort of the unsung hero of the brassica category of vegetables. So it happens to be something that's in season in New England, and I want to try to help share some recipes with you, as well as talk a little bit about how to store and prep and wash cauliflower when you're buying it. Lauren Orsillo is with us as well, our program moderator. And if you have a question, a comment, or an insight you'd like to share at any point during the conversation, you can just type it into the chat, and Lauren will take care of sharing those comments along with also sending you a copy of the slides and the links at the end of today via email. So thank you, Lauren, for your help with that. And we'll get underway. I'm going to do as usual, which is share the slides with you, share my screen, and then we will start talking about cauliflower. I think it's really funny that I had been talking a lot about how cauliflower was in season and how in Massachusetts it's in season, and it's going to be in season now, so really through the months of October. And then I went to get my CSA box, and I didn't have one in my CSA box this week, so I had to stop and pick one up at the grocery store. But at least this episode will be available on demand before you get your cauliflower, and hopefully you'll be able to make use of it at that time if you don't already have one in your crisper drawer. So let's start out with the ideas about how you would take care of your cauliflower once you get it home. Cauliflower is one of those vegetables that can actually last in your fridge for a while, at least 7 days, and if it's farm fresh, typically longer than that if you're storing it correctly. So I'm actually going to spend quite a bit of time today on storing and preparation, and less time on sort of the polishing assembly of the recipe, more on how you make your cauliflower last. So these are a few tips. Don't wash it until you're ready to use it. If you buy it at the grocery store and it comes in that packaged plastic bag, just leave it in that bag and leave it in there until you're ready to use it. I want to mention right away a question I get quite often, which is, what about those little brown spots? Are those little clusters of brown spots that can be sort of over the surface of the cauliflower? Those actually, most of the time, are not an indication that the cauliflower is rotten. It's a sign that the modeling, the small bits of brown modeling, is just a lower amount of boron in the cauliflower. So you can just cut those away. If it's starting to turn bad and mold, obviously that's a different story. But tiny little brown specks in clusters or are sort of modeled throughout the top of the cauliflower are not dangerous or problematic. If they don't appeal to you, you can just kind of cut those little bits out. When you go to wash a cauliflower, I think an error a lot of people make is they take it out of the plastic, they turn on the water, and they take the whole head of cauliflower and just hold it under running water. When actually most of the dirt and debris in a cauliflower is in the underneath side where the leaves are. If you think about how a cauliflower grows in the ground, where most of the stuff you're gonna wanna wash off is actually on the underside of the cauliflower. So I'm showing this picture on the left here where the cauliflower florets have been cut away from the stem. And that's what you wanna do when you're preparing to wash your cauliflower. It's best not to wash it whole, like a whole head at one time, but to actually chunk it up into at least 5 or 6 pieces that you can submerge in water and then rinse and drain before you use it. When you're storing cauliflower, if you get it at the farmer's market and it doesn't come in a plastic bag, you can wrap it in a damp paper towel and store it in a perforated bag. Either a plastic bag that's had some holes cut in it or a mesh bag will work fine. And you want to store it, if you have space, in your crisper drawer set to high humidity. Like I said, about 7 to 10 days. And I'll talk a little bit more about this when we start to go through making our recipe today. There are lots of ways to prepare cauliflower, and as I was preparing for today's session, it occurred to me just how much I like cauliflower, and it's because of its versatility. I think cauliflower is delicious roasted or steamed or sautéed or grilled or riced. If you don't know what that means, I'll talk with you about that in a little bit. Ricing cauliflower is sort of a new trend, I think. Mashed cauliflower is often combined with other types of vegetables, root vegetables. So potatoes or parsnips or turnips or rutabagas are things you can mash along with cauliflower. And also smoothies. This one comes as a surprise to many people, that cauliflower is a vegetable that can be added to smoothies, with most people not even knowing it's there in terms of detecting flavor. And if you have cauliflower on hand, perhaps in your garden or your farm share, and you get to a point in the next couple of weeks where you have a lot of cauliflower and not enough ways or time to make it all, you can actually freeze cauliflower in a pretty simple manner. And we're going to talk about how to do that again today. So lots of ways to prepare cauliflower. And I want to just zoom in on three that I think people have the most questions about. And the first is, what is cauliflower rice and how do you make it? And it, as you see here in the picture, this cauliflower rice is exactly what it sounds like. It's cauliflower that has the shape or texture or consistency of rice. And you make it very simply by just taking raw cauliflower and putting it in your food processor and pulsing it until it has the, until it's about the same size as a grain of rice. I will use cauliflower rice in lots of different types of recipes. You can saute it, you can bake it on a cookie sheet and make it a little bit crispy, and you can also put it in a freezer bag and use it in your smoothie. So that's one way. And cauliflower rice, if you want more information about how to make it, I've incorporated a link that Lauren just shared here from the Minimalist Baker on cauliflower rice and how to make it. For those of you who think you might want to freeze cauliflower, this guide here from Downshiftology tells you what to do. But very simply, when you're trying to freeze cauliflower, you first want to blanch it in boiling water. So you get a big pot of water boiling for 1 or 2 minutes, drop the cauliflower in and cook it for 1 or 2 minutes, then drain it and put it right into an ice bath for another 1 or 2 minutes. And from there, you can just put it into a freezer bag and put it in the freezer for 3 to 6 months. If you are inclined to try making a smoothie that contains cauliflower, I highly recommend using a frozen version of cauliflower in your smoothie. It lends a creamy, thick quality without making the smoothie icy. So if you're interested in how to make a smoothie, I've added my favorite one here, which is a blueberry cauliflower smoothie. It's a Colleen Christensen recipe online. So those are just a few sort of different ways to conceive of cauliflower. And I should mention, you can also buy cauliflower riced already or frozen cauliflower. Frozen cauliflower is actually pretty economical. Buying cauliflower riced is a lot more expensive. So if you have the equipment, a food processor, and the bandwidth to rice it on your own, you'll save quite a bit of money versus trying to buy it frozen or riced in the grocery store. So I'm going to start talking about recipes now for cauliflower. And I had a very difficult time deciding which recipe to choose for today because I didn't even realize how much I like cauliflower and how frequently our family eats it. So I'm going to talk about 7 recipes and make one. And these 7 are really things that I think represent the diversity of cauliflower. And also give you a wide array of different ways you can think of preparing it, especially if you are sort of a 1 or 2 trick pony when it comes to cauliflower. You've got like 1 or 2 things you usually do with it, but you haven't really branched out beyond that. So of course, you know, I love to have people try to bring turmeric into their cooking. These are my 2 top recipes for cauliflower paired with turmeric. One is called cauliflower turmeric rice. So just like we talked about a minute ago, this is cauliflower rice that's got turmeric, and it's kind of like a fried rice. It is a fried rice, actually, with lots of different vegetables. I usually have cashews in this mix. So if you're inclined at all, if you like fried rice, you can actually make it using turmeric and cauliflower. And not long ago, in a Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition focused on turmeric, I made one of my family's all-time favorite recipes, which is the one I'm picturing here. You see the arrow pointing to the bowl, which is a couple cooks crispy breaded cauliflower. And this one is a just showstopper, in my opinion. It's got a wonderful sauce. In fact, this morning when my 7-year-old was looking at my slides with me, she said, "Ooh, is that the one that you're going to make today?" And she was very excited. She refers to this as the cauliflower with a really good crunch. So this one's worth making. If you didn't catch that episode of Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition, I have the link for you here. And I demonstrated how to make this crispy breaded cauliflower recipe in that episode. Another 4 recipes that really round out my top 7 are all from the same cookbook author and food blogger named Laura Wright. And this is called The First Mess. You've heard me talk about this food blogger many times before. her cauliflower recipes, there's really just an endless array of options, but these are my favorites. So I'm just going to briefly tell you one thing about them. The first one is a Napa kale slaw. So think coleslaw with Napa cabbage and kale, and then a crunchy barbecue cauliflower. This recipe is phenomenal. I don't usually use the pickled jalapeno ranch, but you can make it if you want to. It's great even without it. And one of the things I really appreciate about how Laura Wright uses cauliflower is that she elevates cauliflower to the position where it's substituting in for meat. So you usually think about like zucchini or eggplant being sort of like a more meaty, robust kind of vegetable. But cauliflower, if prepared correctly, can really have that same texture and density. So that's how it's used in this recipe. And I think this is just a phenomenal combo. For those of you who are thinking toward the fall and like yourself some shepherd's pie, this recipe is fabulous. It's a shepherd's pie that has lentils instead of ground beef or ground turkey. And instead of just potatoes as the topper, it's got a creamy cauliflower potato mash, like a combo. This recipe, again, is a phenomenal vegetarian replacement for anybody who wants a new twist on shepherd's pie. Laura also has on the first mess a cauliflower burger, and it also has chickpeas. So it's a chickpea and cauliflower burger that has the equivalent of mayo, but it's made from cashews. So these are super creative recipes. And if you have an aspiring cook or perhaps a kid that's homeschooled or going to be around a lot more, a little assistant in the kitchen, these can be really fun ways to engage younger people in creating veggie forward recipes. And lastly, if you are interested in a cauliflower salad, this one is prime for August with the availability of in-season nectarines and cauliflower in New England. And it's a salad. So it's cauliflower salad with nectarine slices and pistachio duca. And if you don't know duca, it is a type of nut and spice combination. It's phenomenal, really adds a punch of flavor. So again, if you're just usually steaming cauliflower or roasting in the oven, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. But I want to help you up the ante to realize just how diverse and wide-ranging you can make cauliflower in your palate. And just here, these are my four favorite cauliflower recipes from one food blog, where you're getting barbecue cauliflower or a cauliflower burger or a salad or a shepherd's pie. And cauliflower is the star in each of these recipes that are just amazing. I'm seeing a comment that's coming in about somebody feeling bloated just listening to this. So we'll talk a little bit more about the brassica vegetables and how to help them be digestively best managed if they give you a little bit of trouble. So I did see that comment come in. We'll come back to that. Okay, my runner-up favorite recipe, tied for the favorite recipe of what we're going to make today, is this recipe by Cookie and Kate, and it's called roasted cauliflower and lentil tacos. Phenomenal. There's not much more I can say about this. This, the first time I made it, became a hit, and it's a regular routine in our house. I want to just draw your attention to the fact that lentils and cauliflower pair very nicely together. And you'll see how that last recipe recommendation I gave you for the shepherd's pie also had lentils. So lentils and cauliflower play off of each other very nicely. So if you're new to either one of those foods, it might be win-win because you can pair them together and really get a full flavor and satisfying flavor. Okay, so we're finally coming up to what we're going to make today, and this is what it is. It's not going to look as beautiful because, like I said, I'm going to spend most of our time on how you prepare this recipe, and I'm not going to go through the full plating of it because I haven't actually cooked the cauliflower yet. I want to show you how I prepare it. This recipe is from a couple cooks, and the link is here for you, and it is cauliflower shawarma, and I love it because it's simple and straightforward, and I also appreciate, you can see here, she serves it with romaine lettuce, and it contains the sauce we're going to make is a creamy tahini yogurt sauce. So you just, on a hot summer night or, you know, a long remote work day, or you've been at work and you're commuting back home, you need something quick and easy. If you have tahini Greek yogurt and a lemon and a head of cauliflower in your house, you'll be able to make cauliflower shawarma. And even if you don't have the whole wheat pitas, I made this recipe last week when in our farm share we had gotten a head of fresh bib lettuce, and we ate the shawarma with the tahini sauce as a lettuce wrap. So this is what we're going to make today. Before we do that, I'm going to pause here to see, Lauren, if there are any questions that have come in so far.
Yes, we did have one question come in, and it was a question about people in a family that might not enjoy cauliflower. If you have a suggestion of, like, what's the best recipe for somebody who might not enjoy it? If is there kind of a way to kind of sneak around the fact that they don't like it?
That's great. So I want to just point you to the slide that we talked through on the different ways to prepare a cauliflower, because I would say to whomever feels like it's not their favorite, how are you preparing it? Has it been frozen and boiled, or frozen and steamed, or is it fresh and roasted? My first suggestion would be to try it in a different way than you've had it before. So if you've never riced cauliflower, make the Love and Lemons fried rice. If you've never breaded cauliflower, make the cauliflower crispy breaded cauliflower. If you've never grilled cauliflower, that's what we're going to talk about today. I'm modifying the recipe from a couple cooks to use my grill. So if you've never grilled cauliflower, that can bring out a real sweet caramelized sort of flavor. And I'm going to show you how I grill cauliflower. We grill cauliflower every week. So I guess my first thought would be, look at that list on ways to prepare cauliflower, that particular slide, and circle in your mind any of the ways you have not yet tried making cauliflower, and then give one of those a go with a corresponding recipe from today's show. Because I think with cauliflower, the versatility of it often means that people might end up liking it riced or even in a smoothie where it's not detectable, and the having it sort of the same old way that they've had it before that hasn't been appealing to them is something to sort of just leave out. So I hope that helps.
That's great. Yes, thank you. And let's see, there was the question that you saw about feeling bloated. I'm not sure if you'll get to that in a little bit or if you want to touch upon that now.
So cauliflower is a brassica vegetable. So it's in the same family as cabbage and kale. And for some people, they notice that same feeling of feeling bloated and gassy after they eat it. And there's a couple thoughts. Some people take Beano, which is a digestive enzyme you can just take at the same time you eat the cauliflower. But I would say the other thing you could think about is that some people notice an improvement if they blanch it first and freeze it and then cook it into soups or stews. And if you also haven't paid attention to your symptoms, if they're worst when the cauliflower is raw versus cooked, that's another thing to take into consideration. So it's kind of like that original question, where you want to think about the way you're eating it or the way you're preparing it. And if you have the bandwidth or the willingness to experiment with trying a different approach, plus or minus an over-the-counter digestive enzyme that you just take that helps reduce gas. And for some people, cauliflower is not their thing. It's not going to be their go-to vegetable. But I just want to say that I think in order to really get a sense of whether or not you tolerate it, it might be useful to try preparing it in a variety of different ways.
That's great. Thank you. We had a couple of things come in just about recipes in general. Someone did say that they mentioned the crispy breaded cauliflower, that's delicious. And then a couple more like indigestion, just comments basically. So I guess my question, I'm trying to make a question out of this statement, but even after roasting and, you know, including some spices, like some Indian spices, and then also some garlic and ginger as well, while it tastes good, it does cause a lot of intestinal discomfort and whatnot. Basically, is that just coming down to the fiber, I guess? This person says that it's too much fiber, and they aren't eating it raw, they are cooking it, but good. It's just too much to have together. So what do you suggest?
Yeah. That there is not, that particular individual's tolerance isn't great. And like I said before, it's in the same. So if that person also has less success with things like cabbage and kale, this is the vegetable that, even though it's white, it doesn't have the same color as those vegetables. It's in the same vegetable family. So if brassica vegetables are problematic, and they are a type of fiber that can be harder to digest if you're experiencing any GI symptoms, for example, related to treatment. So for some people who are experiencing changes, even in their bowel habits, having this type of fiber too much can incite this type of gas and bloating and symptoms. So in fact, that might be a good indication that it's cauliflower won't, like I said, be the star of the dinner plate at your house. And I think that if you've tried, especially if you've tried in a variety of different ways, you can keep eating it, but you might find you're more comfortable if you think about an over-the-counter enzyme Like I mentioned, just one brand is Beano. That's just an example that helps you sort of break down and digest that food. Otherwise, you could certainly avoid cauliflower.
That's perfect. Thank you so much. And that was it for right now. So if you would like to continue.
Let's go a little bit. I'll show you how I make this recipe. And I want to just say back to this notion of how we prepare cauliflower. So here's cauliflower as it would come from in the store, right, wrapped in a plastic bag. And the first thing I want to mention is that people, I find, often put it in their produce drawer upside down with the stem part up. I'll just take this cover off here. And then that's not how you want to store it. Because if you have it this way, the moisture from the leaves and the stem is going to travel down to the florets and create a situation where more moisture gathers here, and that can contribute to the rate at which it goes bad. So when you store cauliflower in your fridge, flip it over and store it this way in the crisper drawer. So the leaves and the stem are down and the florets are facing up, because then the water, any moisture that's trapped in between these crevices here, is moving the right direction back toward the stem, not toward the head. Does that make sense? So this, like I mentioned, I didn't get a CSA cauliflower this week in my farm share. But if you do buy a farmer's market cauliflower, it's not gonna come home with this plastic wrap. So you're not gonna wash it. You're just gonna bring it in just as it is. And you're gonna just take a very damp, barely damp paper towel, just a tiny bit of water. And you're gonna go like this and cover it like a little blanket of your paper towel. And then you're either gonna put it into a plastic bag that's got holes punched in it, or a mesh bag in your crisper drawer at a high humidity setting. You're gonna turn it so that the stem is down. That's the way you're gonna properly store your cauliflower. And then when you're ready to wash it, you're gonna break these chunks off. So you're gonna take chunks like this and you're gonna put them in a bowl of water, submerge them, just let them sit for a couple minutes. I swish it around. And then I put it into a strainer and I rinse it and drain it. So this cauliflower, I already did that with. I rinsed it and drained it because I want the olive oil to stick. So that's the first step when you're preparing your cauliflower for any recipe, really, for preparing or storing. And this recipe, you'll find when you look online, is suggesting that we're gonna roast the cauliflower. But the modification I have made is I happen to like it on the grill. And like I said, since I grill cauliflower so often, I just use the grill to cook the cauliflower. So you put the whole head of cauliflower into a bowl after you've washed and prepared it with 3 tablespoons of olive oil. And those of you who've been along for Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition know I don't measure oil. I just 1, 2, 3. That's how much oil we need. And then you're going to add the flavor here, which is 3 different spices. They're a teaspoon each. So first we're going to do coriander, 1 teaspoon of coriander, 1 teaspoon of paprika, and 1 teaspoon of cumin. And this is what gives this cauliflower that delicious flavor. Cumin, coriander, and sweet paprika, not smoked paprika. Okay. And then we're also gonna put in 1 garlic clove, which I pre-peeled. I didn't mention this in any Zakim's Kitchen editions so far, but when you're making garlic, in any recipe, it's a good idea to smash it and get it out of its paper and then let it have a little time at air temperature, because the active compounds in garlic, the phytonutrients and the antioxidants, are more pronounced in their effect if it has a little time exposed to air. So it's kind of like a nice fine wine that you want to let it breathe. So I let that garlic clove just sit out while I was getting things ready. So we're going to add that. So now we've got olive oil, garlic, and spices, and we're going to also add a little bit of salt and pepper just to taste. And now, this is when you would have your oven preheated to 425 degrees. So salt and pepper, cumin, coriander, paprika, and olive oil, and we're just going to toss this around until it gets coated. I recommend a parchment paper lined baking sheet, because your oven's gonna be at 425 and you're gonna wanna get this cauliflower nice and crispy and golden brown. It will take about 20 to 30 minutes roasting the cauliflower in the oven to do that. Or if you have a griller basket, we've talked about these before, this you can just buy at a kitchen store. It's just a metal basket with holes in it. And I have several of these. We cook vegetables on our grill in the summer most every night. And you can cook almost any vegetable in here, from sweet potatoes to fennel, to cauliflower, to broccoli, you name it, peppers, onions, everything in the basket. So instead of heating my house up on a hot day, putting the oven at 425, or if I was already going to grill other things, like for example, for my CSA, we got corn on the cob and eggplant, all of which I can cook on the grill as well. I'll plan to just heat the grill and take all of these vegetables out to put them on the grill at the same time. So just a slight detour from a couple cooks version of this recipe. I'm doing the cauliflower just as you would, spices and olive oil on it. And then I'm going to dump it into my griller basket and put it on a 425 degree grill and let it have about 20 minutes out there. So it's cooked and a nice brown flavor on the grill. So when you're making this recipe, you cook it on the grill or in the oven, do the roasting. And when you bring it in while it's hot, you're going to squeeze the juice of half a lemon onto the cauliflower. And if you can possibly catch it while it's hot, I find it really soaks up that flavor. And you can also add at that point some chopped fresh cilantro if you have it. So that's part one of the cauliflower shawarma, is getting the cauliflower roasted or in our grill. Any questions on that, Lauren?
Yes, we had a few questions come in. So the first, one of the questions was, is it safe to cook or grill with extra virgin olive oil?
It is. Okay. You can also, if you have a grill that gets really high heat, you would instead just use avocado oil, because that oil has a higher smoke point. So yes, you can use olive oil. And then if you're going to put this on the grill and really crank the grill hot, you might want to use avocado oil.
Okay, perfect. And then coriander seed or whole or crushed?
Good. This is all ground. I'm glad you asked that clarification. All the spices for this recipe are ground. So ground coriander, ground cumin, and then sweet paprika. They're just ground.
Perfect. And then another question about the cooking of it. So I think the recipe calls for in the oven. You prefer to do it on the grill. The next question is, can it also be boiled this way, or would that...
Well, the problem with boiling it is that you really want, what you're going for here is to see how these cauliflower bits are coated in that spice. So the oil has created a bit of a sticky opportunity for the coriander, the cumin, and the paprika to adhere to the surface of the cauliflower. So if you were boiling it, you wouldn't be able to get that full flavor, the shawarma flavor sort of in. And the smell of this is really royal. Good. Okay, sorry.
Okay, there we go. Sorry about that. I misread it.
Yes, the answer is you can broil it, absolutely. And that will get you that nice brown caramelized flavor. So yes, broiling will work. Yeah.
Okay. So sorry to the audience. That was my mistake on that one.
That's okay. Any questions about that part?
No, that looks good. You covered it all in that. We did have one more question come in. I don't know if you know this off the top of your head. What is the maximum temp for hazelnut oil?
I don't know the top of my head.
All right, sorry. You keep going. I can Google it.
Our healthy fats class, that might be deeper than somebody wants to go. I put up the chart of all the different types of oils. I don't think I put a smoke point chart in it.
Okay, so, no worries. I'll look this up and you keep going.
Thank you. We're going to make the sauce now, because this is the real thing that complements the roasted, grilled, or broiled cauliflower, is the sauce. And there are four ingredients, very straightforward. First is tahini. For those that don't know, tahini is a ground sesame paste. It's kind of like peanut butter, but made from sesame seeds. So the first ingredient for this recipe is a quarter cup of tahini. You can see tahini is pretty liquidy, but it actually thickens up when you stir it up. So I'm putting in the quarter cup of tahini first. And then it's a half a cup of Greek yogurt. The recipe calls for full fat, but I have a low fat version. Doesn't really matter. I found this recipe is, there's so much flavor in the tahini that doesn't matter what kind of yogurt you use. You can also sub in a non-dairy yogurt here. So half a cup of yogurt. And I just realized I forgot my other garlic clove. I think I put both of them in the cauliflower. So anyway, you're supposed to put a garlic clove into the sauce, which I used in the cauliflower. So I'll have to get another one of those later. And then you're just going to do a tablespoon of fresh lemon juice. I juiced a whole lemon because remember, when I take that cauliflower off the grill, I'm going to pour this lemon juice over the top of it while it's hot. And the one tablespoon of the lemon juice is going to go into the sauce. And then we're going to take a little tiny whisk and we're just going to whisk this together nice and easy. So we get the sauce. And when you look back at the picture of this later, you'll see how beautiful this sauce is sort of dribbled on top. And it's thickening up here, you can see. So you'd want a garlic clove in there. You can also add salt and pepper. I sometimes find with this tahini, I have to add a little bit of water. See how stiff it gets really quickly? So that was a very watery yogurt and a liquidy tahini, but combining together, there's like this sort of little chemical reaction that happens when you mix tahini with yogurt. So if you feel it stiffening up, you're not doing anything wrong. And if you want the sauce a little thinner, you'll just add some water to it, which is what I'll probably do in a bit. So then you're ready to assemble. You'll either take your pita bread, if you're using like a whole wheat pita bread. I've been making them homemade with my kids, but since we were away last week, I didn't get a chance to, so I had to buy pita. And you'll just put your pita bread down and put the grilled or broiled or roasted cauliflower next. And then I actually like to add some extra toppings. The picture you see here is just romaine lettuce, but I happen to have for today a farm fresh tomato I'm gonna dice up. I also have cucumber from my farm share and romaine lettuce and some pine nuts and feta. So you can dress this up however you like. Shredded purple cabbage would be great on here too. And then when you're done with that, you'll take some of the sauce and sort of dribble it over. And I like this because, you know, you can eat it open face like this, but you can also just fold it up. And it makes a great picnic item if you make a whole plate of a whole bunch of them in advance. And then I'll just fold them all up and wrap them up in a to-go container. And it's a great portable picnic.
That's great. Thank you. We didn't get any more questions, but I did research on the hazelnut oil. I got 430 degrees Fahrenheit as the smoke point for hazelnut oil.
Yes. Thank you, Lauren. You're awesome. And that hazelnut oil would be perfect for this recipe. And just hearing that description and having had this recipe many times before, I think that the flavor would be really nice. So that's a perfectly fine oil to use here.
Perfect. That's great.
I know we're over time. Oh my goodness.
I didn't even realize that either, but I think we did a great job.
Enjoy your cauliflower this week. And I hope you'll join us tomorrow for Zakim's Ask the Nutritionist at 12:45, where I'll be talking about how to manage taste changes that are induced by treatment. So thank you, Lauren. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Have a great day.